بكوب الشراب المرصع باللز ورد انتظرها. بذوق الأمير الرفيع البديع انتظرها. بسبع وسائد محشوة بالسحاب الخفيف انتظرها. بنار البخور النسائي ملء المكان انتظرها. ولا تتعجل، فإن أقبلت بعد موعدها فانتظرها، وإن أقبلت قبل موعدها فانتظرها. ولا تجفل الطير فوق جدائلها وانتظرها لتجلس مرتاحة كالحديقة في أوج زينتها وانتظرها. لكي تتنفس هذا الهواء الغريب على قلبها وانتظرها. تحدث إليها كما يتحدث ناي إلى وتر خائف في الكمان، كأنكما شاهدان على ما يعد غد لكما وانتظرها. ولمع لها ليلها خاتما خاتما وانتظرها. إلى أن يقول لك الليل لم يبقى غيركما في الوجود. فخذها برفق إلى موتك المشتهى. وانتظرها. أنتم على اتصال بشركة كهرباء لبنان. للغات العربية اضغط على الرقم 1. إن مندوبي خدمة الزبائن في خدمتك 24 ساعة في اليوم 7 أيام في الأسبوع. للاستعلام عن قيمة الفاتورة اضغط على الرقم 1. للتبليغ عن عطل اضغط على الرقم 2 أو اضغط على رمز النجمة لتحويلك إلى عاملة الهاتف. عزيزي المتصل، بهدف خدمتك بشكل أفضل سوف يتم تسجيل هذا الاتصال. إن جميع الخطوط مشغولة سوف نصلكم بعاملة الهاتف. شكراً لانتظاركم.
Welcome to the RUYA MAPS live Instagram interview we're doing today.
Hi, thank you for having me.
It's nice to have you, and it was very interesting to just see the film that you've made, which in fact you didn't just make, but that we've just shown, Intathirha, Wait for Her. It's very exciting for me because of the fact that I saw this, you shared with me the inception at the beginning, the very thought of it, and now it's become a full-fledged work, which we were very happy to show last year during the Venice Biennale and the Heartbreak exhibition. Anyway, we're excited to be taking part in the Refugee Week, which is an annual festival that celebrates the contributions, creativity and resilience of refugees worldwide. It's a week-long festival from the 15th to the 21st of June. And the theme this year is called Imagine, and I think it's a very apt theme in the context of this film. So I have a bunch of questions for you that I would love for you to answer in light of seeing the film. So I might just go ahead if that's fine with you.
Of course. Sure.
Okay, so in the film, there is a person seen waiting for the return of electricity in a dilapidated building that looks more like a construction site with where the dominant features are concrete and debris with very little personal belongings, or we don't really understand much other than the fact that there's a feeling of statelessness, of nomadicness, of impermanence. So I wanted to ask you about where this film was shot, but also about this stateless condition, if you like.
Okay, so this film was shot in Lebanon, in Beirut, in the southern part of Beirut, in a Palestinian camp called Burj al Barajna. The thing is, this was a collective project in a way, so the whole like shooting and choosing the location. But it's important to note, and this is also because this is my first film, is that the context, this is like a very sort of site-specific references as for electricity, because if you're not living in Lebanon, you don't know that electricity cuts or these exact locations. So in a way, this was a bit challenging in terms of working on the film. But it's also taking into consideration that Beirut has become a refugee capital. Since the last 10 years, there has been an influx of refugees continuously pouring into Lebanon. So in a way, these ideas of statelessness, refugees, is very present in Lebanon. And what I tried to do is to find a place that does not have a clear landmarks for strictly to avoid identity politics to a certain degree in terms of like visually speaking on the screen. So this neighborhood sort of resonates with a lot of poor neighborhoods in different parts of Lebanon or in Beirut.
Mm-hmm.
So that was to a certain degree also the context of where it was shot, and it's inside a Palestinian refugee camp.
But when you talk about the refugees, I mean, there's been refugees from Syria predominantly in the last 10 years, as well as the existing Palestinian refugees. And so the idea behind it is that it's more about the condition of being a refugee as opposed to a specific identity. Is that
yeah?
Would you
to,
say
to me? I think like the part is, and I feel like I've developed this idea throughout the time, also because I'm Palestinian. So being like the questions of refugees and return is quite present in your life. I'm not personally a refugee. My mother's family is a refugee, but you take it into context. And this also, we can go back to also my practice and this idea of sort of meditative. So you take it into context, and being a refugee is not site specific. It's very personal, but in the same time, it's part of the human condition. So it has these two layers that are very difficult to deal with. And it has been ongoing. You can read, like, for me, Hannah Arendt's notions of statelessness truly helped me contextualize how communities are being evicted, how mass transfer takes place, how suddenly you become, and I don't want to get into for like legally, what does it mean to be a refugee or to be a stateless person?
No, we're happy to stick with the human condition.
So
that's,
that's to be clear, I don't know anything about that. I will not.
Yeah, but the human condition is a good baseline. We can work with that.
Yeah. So in a way, like it's about being a refugee, but just waiting for a proposed solution that is to a certain degree, I mean, after, for instance, in the Palestinian case, after 70 years, Syrians now have been refugees for over 9 years. And when you look at how life becomes, I mean, I'm interested in the mundane part. It's like waiting to going home or waiting for a solution, waiting for something to work out. So there is a lot of waiting taking place when you are a refugee or a stateless, whether it's also bureaucracy in other places in the world. You're waiting for a state to see your work or to recognize you. So this is, I mean, for me, it resonates a lot with my interests. Like, what do you do when you wait, and our perception of time and time as trauma as well.
So speaking of mundane, what I found very interesting is some of the props in the film, which are as mundane and in a way as surreal as possible. I mean, there's a goldfish that is in fact, could arguably be the main protagonist that's sitting in a plastic bag. There's the tub of water with the person's feet with a plastic rubber duck, the hairdryer in the water. But I mean, you have these quirky elements that are quite captivating. Can you tell us more about why you've selected them? What's the point?
Of course. I mean, part of it is just this sort of like childish, you know, like I love them. So it's very childish sort of obsession with ducks and fish. And how do you put, like, when you put the orange ducks in different locations and how it transforms the space. Another part would be, it's something that I've been attempting in my practice, and we still have to see how that works, is to reference other works. And in a way, like, there's this song by Iggy Pop that is, for me, it was fascinating, and there was no need to include it in the film.
What's the song?
It's a soundtrack, and it says, this is a film. The fish is mute, expressionless. The fish doesn't think, because the fish knows everything. And having a golden fish, also with the jokes and with the pop culture of like having a very short-term memory, you know, like animation films that I do enjoy as well. So this idea is that you have a witness that is forgetting every couple of seconds or, you know, a part of a second. So it's very satiristic. Like I like to play on this, but without being too literal or too in your face, you know, or like maybe gimmicky, just to keep it there. So that was why I put the fish, and I find its presence, it completely transforms the space.
It does.
Especially that you don't see the sea. You're living in a city by the sea, but you're not seeing the sea, but there is this fish that seems out of place, but also completely comfortable in the space.
Yeah. But the other side of the film, which is, I think, as a kind of a counter or as a balance to the props, which is also, for me, very interesting, is is the film's narrative. Which is taken from a love poem by Mahmoud Darwish, and I would say a pretty passionate poem that is full of eroticism, especially when it, you know, and the way that it's being narrated is interesting, at least for an Arabic speaker, the tone. So could you tell us a bit more about that, about the poem, and about, what is the significance of this poem, as far as also the author being a principal Palestinian poet, Mahmoud Darwish, meaning?
So I've dealt with something written by Mahmoud Darwish before in my work. And so Mahmoud Darwish has become this figure that a Palestinian collective we look to whenever something happens, like whenever something major happens. Mahmoud Darwish comes out and contextualizes the situation. He comes out with poetry. And in a way, it's sort of like restoration of your will or of your, you know, like resilience. So he took this part. And later on, I read in a couple of his interviews, I can't speak on his behalf, of course, he passed away. But he was saying, like, this is like, he was feeling the burden so much because he has this figure that maybe takes away from him as a poet.
Which burden?
The burden of having to like lift people up or to represent Palestinians, or his topic to be strictly about Palestine, because he did a lot of work about Palestine, but later on he dwelled into different topics. He has a magnificent piece about a conversation with death he had once he had a stroke, and that was in Paris. And then he has his last work is quite, like, to me it's fascinating because it's called the Dice Player, and he goes out and he says that basically I was born by coincidence, a lot of things. Like he's trying to work with his legacy in a way that humanizes himself rather than mm-hmm. having another, you know, like dead object to fetishize about.
Meaning so, Palestine.
Yeah, not, meaning also him as a figure, you know, right. as also like the man poet who loves Palestine and, you know, like, so in a way, I thought he was trying to deconstruct this before it was, like he knew this is going to happen and he tried to deconstruct it to a certain degree.
Yeah, but why did you choose to, I'm keen for you to talk about the style of the narration, the tone of the voice
of
the woman, of course. And what you want to convey.
Yeah, I mean, but it's like Darwish I can dwell on for a bit. So I'll go back to the narration. And Intathirha became very famous at some point because it's a very romantic, I mean, erotic poem about the lover waiting for the lover. And there are, I mean, Arabic-wise, it's very smooth as well. So it's not one of his most complicated work.
So it's accessible.
And it is accessible to a certain degree. But then it was sang by a group, and it's on YouTube. Like you can see the counts. So I'm interested always. I can see like how many people are into this. So it's viral. It went viral at some point. So how do you deal, like, to me, this was also fetishized. So then how do you sort of, how would this text or literature function in a different tone of voice, devoided of emotions entirely? So it becomes very performative, but in a way like monotonous.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same person who is on the phone service. It's someone just reading it out because of repetition. And I think, like, because if you repeat a poem over and over and over again, then you lose, you sort of, like, you. To me, I'm interested to see when you strip away the emotion and the words become more abstract and senseless. So we tried to work on that. It took a lot of time to find a narrator that can say it without personal references or without feeling something. And that was, I think it worked, like in a way. This is not a narrative, like the film or the video is not about a specific narrative. It's about a couple of either visual narratives or like, I would love to say that it's a field of intensities that are mm-hmm. present in this situation. Yeah. I don't know, like, this is not my call. So this is up to people who watched it, but I would love it that if it's sort of a field that is constantly negating or in conflict with each other as well.
Yeah.
Because there's the tea bags as well that I absolutely enjoy. Like it's small stuff that you see over the years, and the activity itself is quite telling.
Right, of the waiting and the kind of
this. Of like how to quantify waiting. Like yeah. this has been also a question. Like how do you quantify time, artistically, visually, in a film, aside from like long shots or slowing down a scene, and this is like. In a lot of bus stops in Ramallah, the central bus stop that takes you to different cities, if you look at the roof, you have a lot of tea bags stuck there, and they're just flying, you know. And
people just throw tea bags up, or
yeah, you're drinking the tea, so then you take the tea bag and then you just throw it up. So in a way, like aside from environmental discussion, let's put this on the side. To me, as an art, I find it fascinating because then it's moving with the wind, and then you can actually see. Like you can tell how many people waited today, or then when decay is taking place. Like when would they fall off? I mean, there are too many things happening in this space.
Yeah.
And to me, I find this fascinating.
Yeah.
Like fascinating in terms of.
So you think the narration, because of also the tempo, allows you for that kind of, highlights that condition of the slowness of the passage of time, possibly.
Yeah, and I think so. And I think it was also an attempt to, I mean, this is my first, as you said, my first video. So it was an attempt to experiment. I love to, yeah, I did a performance, but it wasn't really a video. So it's basically just to see how this would work. Like how would audio fit in? Because I'm used to like very small, manageable embroidery.
We'll get to your embroideries, but I wanted to first maybe in the light of what you said about Darwish and the fact that he was more concerned, or at least at some point he wanted to be a poet of mankind rather than just a Palestinian poet, which, you know, I mean, which includes that if you're like a poet at large, so to speak. And I'm just curious about you as an artist who has a similar identity to him, but who also is interested in communicating things that go beyond your immediate, you know, birth identity or so on, not to negate it, but to be that it's encompassed in part of a larger, you know, volume of your humanity, so to speak. How do you work with that?
I mean, like not to put it in a kitschy way, but to me, I find one, like what I found intellectually speaking, like a way how to decolonize the situation is to take into context human condition, is to take into context that this is, again, it's personal, but it's not particularly personal. So that's one part. And then it's about, you want your work to be relevant to people. I mean, of course, realistically, like that, it depends on what kind of work, but you want to have your art present regardless of, you know, like being a geopolitical agent or conveying sort of banal messages. I mean, like, I don't know. I don't feel comfortable because I feel like there are so many other outlets that you can use. So since Art Academy and since being in Ramallah, and specifically because I studied in Ramallah as well, I mean, it was the first Art Academy. So that was an interesting experience. But, and it's not explicitly said, but you feel it with how like interest works, how people interact. Mm-hmm. So you're expected to represent the oppressed in a very specific manner.
Mm-hmm.
And you get the tools, you have the contemporary tools, etc. And then, you know, like it's quite clear afterwards. But the problem is also growing up is that you are an artist, and what you're reading basically is how do you function as an artist in society rather than, you know, like it's, I'm not a cultural attaché.
Right.
So in a way, so that's one thing. And the other thing, it's very patronizing because, like, honestly, it's just, I am, and I don't mean anything by it, but I'm more than just a Palestinian. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't mean I have, like, it's not being too happy about being Palestinian or too upset. It's a nationality. As Darwish said, I mean, it is really like luck as well. So it becomes about what you do with it. And to me, this was the solution, like after realizing, maybe say like a little bit traumatic experience that you do not have full control. So it's the same in exhibition, in a video that you want everything to be like perfect, is that, you know, you become more aware of context, of how you present your work and how you what do you say in specific situations and how do you perform this identity? Because it can be more encompassing rather than, you know, like rather than holding you back.
Yeah.
And so
moving on, because I think this is a very important point that you've just made. And I guess in the context of, you know, fetishizing or the kind of expectation of what it means to be a Palestinian artist, I mean, you've in an interview done a few years ago, you said that finding beauty in a moment of horror is even is much harder than actually, you know, showing that horror, which I find really interesting. Can you say a bit more about that?
Yeah, I mean, like I reject the notion of pornographic violence. I don't like it. This idea that, and then the work itself, it becomes also like a moral decision. So you have something there, and then it's no longer only about the artwork. It becomes about your, like, what do you say? So to me, I think first of all, as a craftsperson, I do take really a lot of attention to details because I love this, and I love, like, I enjoy the finish because I work with fabric and embroidery. So doing a film after embroidery is really interesting, you know, like trying to stitch that. So that's one thing. And then the other thing is that, like, showing beauty and redefining beauty within an artwork in this context is not escapism at all. And it's this idea that despair and joy can coexist. It doesn't mean like being this, like, despair is just acknowledging the truth, which I'm paraphrasing Franco Berardi before, philosopher that I absolutely love. And so the idea is that we do have the possibility for joy and the possibility, and in the same time acknowledging the truth.
Right. So is this where you take satire as a way to communicate maybe the political, or is it to depoliticize, or is it to I mean, how do you feel? Let's say you're in exploring this passage of time alongside the beauty of the horror, so to speak. How do you? What is your signature, if you like?
So it's again, it's a you know, like, it's a work in progress. So. In a way, I think of it as, first of all, storytelling. So, you know, and the direct reference to the storyteller, Walter Benjamin, and then what do you do? But it's also creating, and I mean, the term is very loosely defined, but I believe, I think that when you have satire, it gives you a certain amount of autonomy, and it is resistance to a certain degree. So you're sort of like providing this intense resistance to either the location or the visual aspect or the meaning of this or how you deal with the material, but in a satirical way. So I think it's more subtle and it's less intense. It's not about, you know, preaching, or it's not about saying this is right, this is wrong, or my personal opinion. I have other outlets for that. It's about particularly creating this thing that is constantly like at this sort of, you know, like this again field of anxiety, and satire in this location functions quite well to me, I feel.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to just from that, because obviously when your artistic practice is focused on as you say, mostly smaller objects that you interact with directly, whether it's through your sculptures or particularly your embroideries, that are very distinct, which also are about, you know, there's a whole kind of relationship with time and the deceleration of time, using your own words, and what you've mentioned before as far as flattening, this curve of violence. Can you say more about that?
The idea is, like in my practice, I do a lot of embroidery and it's manual labor, so I'm doing it myself. And it becomes this performative act. I feel it's also sculptural, and there is an aspect of time continuously that is part of the work. It's growing in your hand. And it's pixelated as well. I mean, to me, it resonates on so many levels. Like, it's also comfortable, it's intimate. And this is part of my work as well. I always work from inside my house. My studio is basically like a living room and the kitchen. This is where the material I get. But it's when you're doing embroidery and you're tapping into a collective labor, basically, that is being done all over the world, then there is this aspect of embroidery that slows things down, that basically flattens the curve of trauma, of violence that we're seeing. So it's not about stopping it. It's just like, you know, you flatten the curve a little. And
With the purpose of
acknowledging, or with the purpose of, I mean, to me, it's always been that we need to discuss trauma. We need to look at, not, like, again, this is not a moral judgment, but personal view, I think we should look at horror in the face, what is happening now. And this is our times. And this is what we do about it. So this is not, it's about like how I see it. I see that, yeah, we should look at horror in the face, but it also becomes like a coping mechanism. So I cope with it while I'm doing this embroidery. I do white on white, which is also useless. And I find it funny. I mean, it's useless. Thank you. No, I mean, like to a professional embroiderer, I asked a woman, and this is basically the title of the work. I asked her, like, would you please do this? Because I love Malevich's piece, like white. And I was trying to redo that and work with embroidery strictly as form. And she refused. She said, like, no, I don't want to. And I asked her, like, why not? I'm going to pay you as much as you would like, because I know this might bore you. And she's like, this is a waste of time. And I was like, precisely. This is like, I want to do labor for labor. And all these notions, I mean, I feel a little bit are being more discussed now that we've been stuck at home for a while and been trying to flatten the curve collectively. So,
so Majd, I wanted to basically wrap up the interview with going back to the theme of the Refugee Week being imagined, the imagination, in the context of the film. I mean, the crux of the film, in a way, I mean, at least my take on it, is that there is a suspension. We don't know. We think we know what's going to happen, but we don't know, because it's at that moment before anything happens, the waiting. And so can you tell me what, if you see anything at all between the relationship of the imagination and waiting, imagining and waiting?
I think like imagination basically can prove, like it can not prove, like it can provide a potential for this, like a potential alternative for this space, where it becomes dealt with on a collective level, where it's in a way, I see waiting can be devastating for communities. And of course, I'm aware of my own privilege or my sensitivity to the topic. So, But waiting can be quite devastating. So then what do we do while we wait is a question that I'm really interested in. And I think imagination could be, shared imagination would be a potential way out of this. Shared imagination of everything, I mean, like of visual narrative, of how we tell our stories. I mean, we need a new Walter Benjamin. I mean, now is the time. Another Hannah Arendt. It's happening. I don't mean the figures. I mean, it's happening now. You can see it in the world. But this is the time. I mean, we're hungry for new ideas. And our literature, our intellectual production for the time being, it's brilliant. But we're still waiting for this leap, this leap forward. And I think waiting can maybe trigger this.
Yes, absolutely.
So it's no longer a person. It can be a small collective. It can be an anonymous collective. Yeah. So we have these possibilities. So it's a fine balance between, you know, like being a little bit too ironic and using ironic autonomy to a certain degree and satire. But I think irony is a very strong tool.
Yeah.
It can resolve, can basically truly help with imagination.
Yes, and I mean, on this note, I think we're gonna have to wrap up, and we will wait and imagine what you're gonna come up with next. So I think it's we look forward to that. I'm sure it's gonna be very interesting. So thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
And well done on the film.
Thank you. I hope people enjoyed it. Thank you.
Bye.